Hey, everybody. Welcome to another episode of the Chad Prather Show. As always, we are happy and thrilled that you are taking the time to listen to us on whatever podcast app you're using, or maybe you're watching it on Facebook or YouTube. I hope you're watching it on YouTube so we can keep counting the numbers. You know that's important to us. We like the analytics and the data. So good to be here back in Studio 22, the blazing, sweltering, hot Studio 22. It hadn't gotten too far into the heat of the day yet, so I'm not coming out of the jacket just yet. Party Foul Steve is over there surfing the web in his unapologetic Patriot from Nine Line Apparel. That's a pretty design I came up with right there. I know. You're looking good. Got your Fusik hat on. You got your microphone turned on?
Yeah, it's on okay. Now.
You're a beautiful man.
It's Steve, Monday.
Steve and technology, not always a fine fit. And Hot News Natalie, she's not in the studio today. She's been down in Orlando, Florida, and she's been replaced with someone, a girl prettier than her. Look at Sona over there just hanging out. She's kind of blends right into that chair there.
She's
folks
relaxed.
Have to look close. Yeah, she needs a vanity light on her over there. Yeah. And of course, Puppet Master Mark is sitting over here in the Star Trek whatever command center.
Command,
I don't even
center,
know what we call
it is.
On the bridge. That's what they call it in Star Trek. Yeah.
Yeah.
You look, are you a Trekkie?
No, not at all. Not
you
at all.
Star Wars guy?
Not
more
really.
Star Wars.
I've
Star
actually
Trek.
I haven't even seen all the Star Wars movies.
What?
I've seen like the first three, I think.
You're not the nerd I thought you were.
Well, thank you. I guess that's good. I don't know if that's a good thing or a bad thing, but I'll take it.
Right. Anyway, yeah. So I don't know. Star Wars and that kind of stuff, that crap went downhill a long time ago to me. But anyway, sitting here in the hot seat with me is my buddy Jamie Popwell, all the way from Opelika, Alabama. That rolls off the tongue, doesn't it? You don't meet a lot of folks from Opelika.
No, not many. Not that will admit that they came from Opelika because nobody knows where it is.
Exactly. So for those of you wanting to know about Sona sitting over there in the peanut gallery taking it easy next to Party Foul Steve, Sona belongs to Jamie and sweetheart of a dog. Glad she's here. And you changed your flight, actually, because I'm running late. I was running late today because of my wife.
Fashionably late.
Fashionably late by an hour. I was an hour late. And I believe in the mantra of being on time all the time, except some of the time, then be ahead of time. Unless you're Party Foul Steve, he's ahead of time by like 3 hours.
Yeah.
He wants out of his house so bad, he'll sit by the door with his bags packed at 4 o'clock in the morning, waiting on a 10 o'clock flight. I'm telling you, he can't stand being home.
True story.
He can't stand being home. So we were just together over at the Chris Kyle Memorial Benefit.
Yep.
And hung out over there over the weekend and had a blast. And that was a big event, man. They had a lot of folks turn up.
Yeah.
Now, if you talk to the Kyles, if you talk to Jeff Kyle or Wayne Kyle, you think it's the end of the world, like it's the apocalypse, like this is going to be the worst event we've ever had. Nobody's going to show up. We're going to waste all our money. And I mean, and I'm like nervous thinking, well, they ain't going to have but 100 people there.
Yeah.
And
it was packed.
It was packed, man.
It was packed.
And
a lot of Patriots in that
a lot.
Room Saturday night.
I said the other night, I said, you know, some of that room scares me because about 50% of the people in the room either been shot or blown up. So, you know, there's some tough SOBs in there.
Yeah, you're
you
right.
Know?
You're right.
I mean, there was I'll put it to you like this, Mark. There were about 1,000 people in there, but only about 800 legs. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, that's true, too. Yeah.
Yeah, a lot of stuff going on there. A lot of stories.
Yeah.
A lot of stories. I want your story, though. Opelika, Alabama, you founded Flags for Vets, and we were talking before this thing, and it's a significant deal. Why flags? Why is that important?
Honestly, a couple of years ago, right before this administration took over, you guys will remember, maybe you do, maybe you don't, social media was blowing up with people doing stupid stuff to our flag.
Right.
All these challenges about what you could do to the flag, burning it and everything that you can imagine. And that infuriated me. And I guess short of going and killing everybody that did it, I decided I'd do something a little more positive, put a positive spin to it. And so I thought, well, you know what? Every time I see this on social media, I'll put a flag up for it.
Nice.
And that's kind of how this started. And from a more spiritual side, I really felt like this is something that God was leading me down a road to do as well. And just kind of felt that pull, that tug. I've served my country or my community for my entire life, toted a gun, whether it's in the Marine Corps, in law enforcement, or contracting. And this was just my way of continuing to pay it forward and continue to serve others.
Yeah. And that's the funny thing about it is I know folks, you know, they might go to your website or check things out because it's flagsforvets.us, right?
Correct.
And so you go to that, and I mean, you're putting flags up all over the country.
Yeah.
And because you're right, you know, my friend, country singer Neil McCoy, he started getting on Facebook when all that stuff was going on, and every morning he's just wherever he was every morning, faithfully he'd do the Pledge of Allegiance,
yep,
and kind of lead people through it.
Yep.
And that's something that people have been, it's been lost, you know. We've had this stuff going on with the protests from NFL players and people desecrating the flag, stepping on the flag, you know, burning the flag, all these crazy things. It pisses me off. I mean, it really does, because, you know, I think of how much blood's been shed and lives given and sacrificed for our liberty, and that flag's a symbol of that.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
You know, and so I think Neil's done like 1,400 straight days now of doing this thing.
I remember.
And it's, you know, he's written got some songs he's released about it, and it's an important thing. And I think that people are kind of losing this sense of patriotism in America. Do you find that to be true? I know in the vet community it's one thing, but I'm talking about the general populace out there in America.
Well, and so far, 22 states we've hit. Mm-hmm. And of those 22 states, admittedly, most of them are in the South. I have been as far as Michigan. And as far west, I guess you could say, as Idaho and South Dakota, and everywhere that I have been in those states still have those patriotic roots. Right. Now, some more so than others, you know, the Texas and the Alabama, Georgias, and the Bible Belt, so to speak. But I, as a general rule, I have seen patriotism everywhere I have gone. Mm-hmm. I'm sure there are places in this country where patriotism probably isn't what it needs to be. And I said something in an interview not long after I started when someone asked me why I was doing this. And I said, you remember the weeks following 9/11, and you couldn't drive down a city street, a neighborhood, or go by a business and not see a American flag hanging right somewhere. Patriotism was at an all-time high, I guess you could argue, since World War II ended. And that's what I longed for. That's what I wanted to see more of, is flagpoles and flags all over the country again, and people unashamed to fly the American flag. And like you said, so many people have died for that, and so many people have bled for and given everything they have just for that flag. And so getting back to that level of patriotism is really what I hope I can start that wave of.
Well, I told you, you know, Memorial Day, Veterans Day, the very 4th of July, different holidays that, you know, happen throughout the year. We live in a neighborhood where they'll come out and distribute the flags, and you'll see our streets just lined with the flags. It's a beautiful thing. I honestly wish it was that way 365 days a year.
Right.
And we've talked about, I want to put a flagpole at my house. I want to put a permanent flagpole at my house so everybody can see it, especially the people across the street from me that vote for Beto O'Rourke.
I'm making my eye twitch, man. Stop.
I want everybody, and I don't mean, you know, I always say, I mean, I'm on the road nonstop doing all these shows, and every place I go, I say, everybody in America has their own version of patriotism. Some of them just are wrong about it, you know, and they, if they cut them, they'd bleed their own type of red, white, and blue. But we were in Dubuque, Iowa, did a show up there, and a girl that was the marketing manager for the theater, she said, have you thought about changing the name of your tour, which is Star Spangled Banter? And I said, what's wrong with that? And she said, well, it just offends people. And I said, Star Spangled Banter? I mean, does a Star Spangled Banner offend? She said, yeah. And I said, does the concept of patriotism offend? Yeah. I said, American flag offend? Yeah. I said, that's the dumbest crap I've ever heard in my life. Why do you live in a country and you don't embrace the patriotism that goes along with it?
Absolutely. I know of a lot of places that you can go that they don't share that same patriotism. And please, I'll help you pack your bags.
Exactly.
I mean, if you don't want to be here, nobody's keeping you here.
Exactly.
Go spend some time in Afghanistan. I can tell you what it's like in Iraq, in Bosnia. I mean, I just don't even get me started on that. We only have an hour.
Oh, I want to get him started, Mark.
Oh, Lord.
I want to get him started.
You throw cold water on me to shut me up, I'm telling you.
I want to get him started. You go to Steve's house, you pull up at Party Foul's house, and I gave him this little deal that was a handmade wooden plaque, and it says, it's got an American flag across the banner on the top, and it says, take a knee, my ass. And down below is another little plaque that says, I stand. And I'm like, and Steve's got, he got some liberal neighbors over there. That,
I do.
I joke about
my flag, too. So.
You do. I joke about, you know, liberal. I know a lot of folks on the left who truly embrace patriotism and love this country, and they do. I'm talking about the flakes that are out there. Yep. And there's flakes on the right and the left, so I will qualify it by saying that, because it's the truth. I was at a political event over the weekend and spoke down there, and I'm telling you, it's almost like going to a church revival. Some of these political deals, I'm like, what level of nerd you got to be that you just live at a political speech rally nonstop? I mean, It's kind of funny, but anyway, I want to know how you got in this thing. Tell me the story. So you went in the Marines.
I was 17 years old in 1982, I should say. Enlisted, delayed entry program to Marine Corps. My mom and dad didn't have money for me to go to college.
Right.
Didn't want to go to college. I didn't know what I was going to do with my life. And so I thought, well, I guess I need to serve. That was at the time. Not many people in my school went into the service. They went in to college. And so I was one of the few that decided to go into the military. So 3 days after my 18th birthday, I'm standing on the yellow footprints of Paris Island wondering what the hell I was doing. Getting called everything but a child of God, but
isn't that where they train women Marines?
That's 1st Battalion. I was 3rd Battalion, oh, okay. I didn't see anything look even close to a female for about 3 months.
That Master Sergeant got awful cute.
Yeah, I'm telling you, that senior DI, that gunny man, I'm telling you, he was hot. But no, seriously, I went into Marine Corps and I went in open contract 0311 because my recruiter told me I could be anything I wanted to be, you know. And they never lie, right?
No, I
should have known better. He was a sergeant.
That's a hell of
from,
a sales pitch they got right there, boy.
He was a sergeant from Bronx, New York. And first of all, we almost couldn't communicate with each other because he was down in Alabama recruiting, and I walked in and I didn't understand him. He didn't understand me. But the general gist of it was, is I went in 0311, open contract, and about 2 months into boot camp, I get pulled into one of the company offices, and there was a Marine captain there from 8th and I. And made the pitch, hey, we're looking for Yankee White potential and candidates. I didn't know what Yankee White was. I had no idea. But I said, shoot, sign me up. And I got my orders cut after my boot camp, went through AIT at Lejeune and Geiger, and then from there went straight to D.C. to Marine Barracks 8th and I, and showed up, and they gave me a set of dress blues and said, you're going to wear these a lot more than you're going to wear those camis. And camis is a term that I'm sure Steve would be familiar with. But
yeah. See, Steve's options were either go wear those camis or you can wear a prison uniform.
Oh, really?
That's back. That was that generation.
Yeah,
right.
Well,
there.
We knew a couple of those, too.
So I chose wisely.
Yes, you did.
But I promise you this, I bring that up because it's funny what Steve could have gone to jail over.
Yeah.
That's a pretty funny.
We ain't going to talk about it.
No, I know. People are like, oh, he's a hardened criminal. No, he's just a dumb redneck.
We all got a little bit of that.
Exactly.
In us. That's for sure. So, I did about, I don't know, 4 or 5 months there, got farmed out to a couple of HU details. Mm-hmm. Got shipped down to Williamsburg, Virginia, and did 47 days down there when President Reagan at the time had the economic summit in Williamsburg, and he loved Marines so much. He wanted a group of Marines around him, and so I got put in with 16 other jarheads. We went down there and stood ceremonial post outside the doors and partied like rock stars when we wasn't working.
Yeah.
But, you know, that's a Marine Corps for you, right? and then ended up at the Pentagon for 6 months, standing outside of Casper Weinberger's door, saluting everything with brass and getting tennis elbow. And then March 84, I got sent up to Camp David and spent 18 months up there with Reagan. Mm. And best duty I'll ever have. I just 18, 19-year-old Lance Corporal from Alabama and amongst the greatest president I think we've ever had.
Yeah.
So I got out of the Marine Corps in 88 and started doing law enforcement. Mm-hmm. Spent 16 years as a cop and then realized after working 4 jobs for so many years with 2 kids and wasn't going to make enough money. So I started contracting and spent the next 12 years essentially bouncing back and forth between Iraq and Afghanistan, and came home for good in January 2015. And this is the abbreviated version. And January 17 started Flags for Vets.
Yeah.
So, kind of got me where I am today. And like I said before, I'm 54 years old now. I was working when I came home in 2015. I was working for a company doing some consulting for them, security consulting, and helping them try to get some State Department contracts through the 8A program. They were Alaska Native Corporation, so they were trying to break into the State Department piece. And that worked out for about 18 months. And I got a call 3 days before Christmas. And the CEO said, Jamie, I'm sorry, we don't have the money anymore to keep chasing these contracts, and we're going to have to let you go. So, 52 years old, never been unemployed in my life, and didn't know what I wanted to do, but I knew that I still had some service left in me.
Yeah.
Tried to re-enlist in the Marine Corps, jokingly, of course, but would have if that had taken me. And this just seemed like the natural thing to do, giving back to others and continuing to serve others, putting others before self, and that's what we're all good at doing, correct?
You know, flagsforvets.us. Look at Sona over there. She She's getting involved.
Completely
with the show
disinterested
now.
In this.
I know. I love it. She is too. She'll get over there and stretch and get all relaxed and readjust herself and comfortable living the life of Riley.
Natalie, she doesn't let me do this.
Well, I mean, you
Natalie,
go jail for
you
doing
can't
stuff
pet
like
Natalie.
That.
Nope.
Like that. She lets me pet her.
There's a law against that somewhere. I mean, I know there is. This is Texas.
I really pissed people off over the weekend, though, because I said, I posted a cartoon where this guy's had his hand out to the dog's nose and said, the normal way you greet, you know, and I said, but the way Joe Biden greets, and it showed the dude had his nose around in the dog's ass sniffing. And people were telling me I needed to apologize to Joe Biden's followers.
Yeah, all 10
like,
of
Joe
them.
Joe Biden ain't got no followers.
He got 10, 12. It's like my Twitter account. I think I got 6 followers. I hope to get four more by the time today's over. So if y'all don't mind, follow me on Twitter. I'll have 10.
Yeah, if I see Party Foul over there sniffing Sona's butt, we got a problem. But I've seen him do that to Natalie. What is the process? So the process, somebody wants to put up a flag or talk through it. I mean,
well,
it's more than just giving somebody a flag.
Well, I mean,
it can be as simple as that.
It really is. It's so simple that people can't really wrap their head around it. My criteria for this were simple, and I could have gone through, you know, you needed to be combat wounded or you need to have fought in a conflict or whatever, a particular branch of service. Hang on a second. Come here.
No, she's fine.
Damn.
She knows what's up. She knows when she's being talked about.
Damn. Hey, damn.
Look at that. That's a good dog right there.
Good girl. Stay. So
that's why I only keep pictures of Willie. Yeah. Willie be everything in this studio, Willie pee on everything vertical in here. He'd be lifting his
before
leg.
Before it's all said and done, she's probably going to get up in my lap because that's just how she is. That's but and sometimes she can sense if I get a little, stressed or anxious or whatever, she can sense a little bit of that. So that may be what she's sensing now. With the thumping tail. It's all good, I promise. So my criteria were simple. I decided, if you served honorably in one of the 5 branches of service, and that's just going to be that's just going to be what qualifies you. So I started, what I started was with my flagpole. We had just moved back from Texas. I had a 30-footer that I'd been flying in my house wherever I was. And I hadn't had a chance because I was busy. I hadn't had a chance to put it up yet. So I decided, I have plenty of time now. I'm unemployed. Sure. So put my flag up, posted it on social media and said, hey, if anybody else out there has a flag that they want to honor a veteran with, I'll do it. And I had a couple locally that took me up on the offer, and I paid some materials. And my mom called me one day and said, you know, your dad's always wanted a flagpole. And I said, I consider it done. Went and put one up for him, and the neighbor across the street, unbeknownst to me, they lived there for 47 years and had no idea. Mr. W.J. Browning was a Marine from Korea. Hmm. Never knew it. And he saw our flagpole at Mom and Dad's and said, I want a flagpole too. And I said, make it happen. So my first official flagpole installation was January 27th. It was a Vietnam veteran named Ralph Powell, who has since passed away. But I just started doing it that way. And the process, the first couple of flags, oh man, they probably took me 2.5-3 hours. I didn't know what I was doing. I was lost. And it's a simple process now, less than an hour. But that's really how this started, is that, you know, putting it out on social media and saying, hey, if you know anybody you want to honor with a flag and a flagpole, I'll do it. If you can help me sponsor them, if you can pay for the materials, I'll do the rest for you. And I took my show on the road, really just kind of did some counties around where I live. Did a couple just over the state line in Georgia. And you know, one thing led to another. And this past Saturday just hit our 342nd installation. Oh, wow. And nice. And I've got probably close to 100 on a waiting list right now.
That's great.
So and we have a Medal of Honor recipient, Benny Adkins, retired Command Sergeant Major, an old SF guy that lives in Opelika, and was awarded the Medal of Honor 2014, I think. And before that, he had a CPA firm for more than 30 years, and nobody even knew about that he was, you know, as decorated as he was, wounded 18 separate times. But Benny lived right up the road from me, and I stalked him for about 3 months, and I told him at some point, Sergeant Major, I'm going to put a flag up for you. And so Easter weekend, the day before Easter, that Saturday, he had been on the road traveling all week, and that Saturday morning, about 11:30, I showed up, knocked on his door, and he came to the door, still out of pajamas on, and hadn't shaved in a couple of days. And I said, Sergeant Major, I promised you I was going to put a flag up for you, so either one or two things going to happen. Either you're going to call the police, or I'm going to put a flag up for you, or both. But I'll tell you this, I know most of the police officers in Opelika, so I probably stand a pretty good chance of getting off on it.
Yeah.
And he said, well, come on in. We'll check with the missus. And so we put a flagpole up for Benny, and that started that piece. And since then, we've done 12 Medal of Honor recipients. And,
oh, wow.
And we've got a mutual friend, Woody Williams. Have you met Woody?
Sure.
So put one up for Woody. One of only four remaining World War II recipients alive, and the last living recipient that's a Marine veteran. So anyway, that's how this started. And I made a promise to myself that I would do my first year. I wanted to do 200 installations, and I did 200 on the 365th day. I did my first 200. And after that, I tried to keep it at about 100 a year. And so made 100 last year. I'm 42 into my 100 this year. So,
yeah, that's pretty amazing. I mean, you know, Steve, I don't know why you don't do things more, you know, important in life like this. You know, I mean, why don't you?
Well, I do quite a bit with you.
That's a waste of time.
I spend a lot of time with you.
I want to know, so if somebody goes to flagsforvets.us, they can get in touch with you. If they know someone that's a combat veteran or a wounded veteran, they can request that and get on that list.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, absolutely. And honestly, they don't have to be either. I mean, I did one for a 37-year retired command sergeant major in the Army that was responsible for finance. Mm-hmm. And for 37 years, he made sure everybody got paid. Yeah. And he had the nerve to tell me that he didn't think he raided a flagpole. Because he didn't serve in a conflict.
Right.
And this is like anything else. You know, when you sign on the dotted line, right, Steve, you don't pick your wars.
Nope.
They just tell you where to go, and you salute smartly, and you move on. And if you get called to serve overseas in a conflict, well, then you just do your duty.
Yeah.
But that's the one thing that we all have in common is that we all signed on a dotted line and raised our right hand and swore an oath to the Constitution and said, hey, man, here I am. Yep. There's a blank check. And I know that cliche is used a lot, but it means a lot. I mean, it really does. And so that's why I just kind of a broad brush approach with me. I just wanted to make sure that one person that did a 3-year hitch out of high school that didn't do anything but maybe turned a wrench or two on a truck that still served his or her country, they deserve a flagpole like the rest of them.
Yeah.
And, you know, this is my calling. This is what I'll do till the day I die. I know it. I feel it in my heart, and I still got a lot of years left in me, and I just sit back and watch how many I can put up.
Yeah.
So
tell me that story again you were telling me about when you put one up at your place. So we were talking about homeowners associations.
Yeah,
and you would think living here in Texas that, but you know, folks that don't live in Texas think we just do whatever we want to do down here in Texas because we just, by God, Texans. And you know, for the most part, that humble arrogance is pretty true. We swagger a little bit.
Yeah.
But HOAs in Texas could be pretty daggum tough. Homeowners associations could get you.
Yeah.
Was that in Texas when you did that, or was that back in Alabama?
It was here in Fort Worth, as a matter of fact. 2012, we built a house off of Basswood and 35 and at a gated community somewhere close by, and I'll just leave that part out.
Yeah.
But anyway, before we built the house, we read the covenants of the Homeowners Association, and it said in there that flagpoles were prohibited. You could fly a flag, but in-ground flagpoles were prohibited. And I thought, well, just for craps and grins, I'd just go ahead and apply anyway. Mm-hmm. And so not only did I apply, but I put pictures up. You know, hey, here's my flagpole right now. It was in the ground at the house we were living in. This is what I'm going to put up, and this is how I'm going to do it. It's a classy, tasteful way. I've got solar lights at the base, you know, landscaping lights, so it'll be flown at night. And so this completed the application and submitted it in, and 2 weeks later I get a letter back saying, hey, you're approved. So cool. Yeah. Veterans Day weekend of 2012 on November 10th, November 11th. Well, November 10th, our birthday,
Marine Corps,
right?
Birthday.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I did it on our birthday, Marine Corps birthday, that is. Mm-hmm. And put my flag up. And about 2 weeks later, I get a letter in the mail from the Homeowner Association that said, you're going to take that down. You're in violation. And so I was polite about it, as polite as I could be without, you know, going over there and throat punching somebody. But I sent him a scanned copy of the letter that I received from the manager of the HOA and said, hey, you guys approved this. And I sent pictures, and they came back and said, well, it was a mistake. We didn't realize it was an in-ground flagpole. So I said, well, I'll tell you this. I said, you know, you meet me Saturday morning about 10 o'clock out front yard, and I'll have every news agency between here and 100 miles parked there next to me, and you guys come tell me I can take my flagpole down. Mm-hmm. And I never heard from them again. So 4 years later, when we moved back to Alabama, I dug that thing up, took it home with me, and that's what's parked in my front yard right now. So. Yeah, I mean, I'm like you. Easy to beg, forget us, it is permission.
Yeah.
And we've done that for a couple of veterans that we've showed up at their houses, and they've got homeowners associations, and I've told them, hey, look, this is on you. I mean, you know, me personally, I'll put it up. I don't care. I don't have to live here. You do. And we've put them up, and they've gotten some grief from HOAs, and like you and me and anybody else that served said, screw you.
Yeah.
Come make me take it down.
Yeah.
So, you know, and that's what this, you know, HOAs are there for a reason. And don't, you know, HOAs are HOAs, but everything within reason. But when you tell someone they can't fly an American flag in ground or any way they want to fly it, for that matter, then you're infringing on some rights that, by God, we serve for. And so I just don't see that much anymore. I don't see a whole lot of people getting told they can't put
freedom,
one up.
Freedom and liberty. We toss those words around. It's a quirky thing. You know, we talk about living in a free country and being free to do whatever we want to do. And that doesn't mean we are in anarchy where there are not laws and there's not rules and things like that. But because of our freedom, America's always been a pretty quirky place in that free speech, by and large, has not been restricted, although we're seeing some attempts at that these days, especially things like social media. And, you know, the mainstream media is extremely biased as well. And so we kind of, it's weird how we get interpreted. But, you know, you were in the service in the 80s. You talked about serving under Reagan and those things. I mean, the world was crazy then, too.
Yeah.
And America was crazy then, too. We've always had that revolutionary patriot blood running through us that makes us a little haywire.
Yeah.
Anyway, we got that attitude about
us. We wear it proudly,
and,
though.
And it doesn't, we do. And it doesn't matter where you stand on the political spectrum, either side. We just have a little bit of crazy running through us. I mean, where else in the world are you going to go where you got monster truck rallies and, you know, and bikini contests and white t-shirt contests? And I mean, you know, they don't do that in Yemen.
No. I didn't see a whole lot of that in downtown
wet
Kabul
burka
either.
Contest.
No. What did you say, Steve?
Wet burka contest.
Wet burka contest. Yeah. It's still black. Look like a swimsuit, like a trash bag that got wet.
Yeah, we used to joke those eyes were just killer eyes, but you know you had to think that they're just beautiful underneath, and all you could see is her eyes. And well,
yeah. Did you see that video where those? I guess it was five or six women in burkas got in a fight with each other, and it was just and they were throwing the kids on the ground. They were holding the baby and just kept dropping the baby, picked the baby up, dropped the baby again. And I mean, I posted it, and somebody sent me a message and said. Cars driving by, I said, well, that baby's going to get hit. I said, the baby's done been hit five times by the pavement. But, you know, when that one girl snatched that burka off the other girl's head, I didn't fall into a raging lust or anything. You know what I mean?
No.
But it's funny, you know, we live in this country where we're being compromised in so many ways these days because people are offended by things like an American flag. I mean, that's your flag. It's your flag.
I will say this, and there's it's no coincidence since this administration has come in, I have seen less and less of the craziness that went on the 4 years or the 8 years previous to that. I do see more people coming out now, and part of it makes me a little sad that they should have been there all along.
I mean, it
doesn't take this administration for people to come out and say, "My God, I'm an American and I want to do this. I want to fly my flag." But I have seen a trend more towards the support for patriotism, and you know, the president is a huge supporter of the military. It puts America first. I believe that with my heart.
Yeah.
Do I agree sometimes with how he goes about doing it? No. But sure. I mean, you know what? I didn't pay him. I'm not paying him to do this job. I voted for him, and I don't care how he gets it done as long as he gets it done, kind of thing. But I just the whole patriotism thing for me, I just have never been able to wrap my head around why somebody that's born in the greatest country in the world is not a patriot 24 hours a day.
Yeah.
Now, you may not have to show it. You don't have to wear the red, white, and blue every day. But, you know, when it comes time to stand up, you need to stand up and be that person that we all know you can be and be a patriot. So I'm just that guy, man.
Yeah.
And I know everyone in this room is the same way with me, and we're all like-minded in that, especially those of us that have sworn to take that oath. So.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm wired up the same way. I realized a number of years ago, you know, because I do comedy and humor, and I have this huge platform on things like social media and a large following, and, you know, we got tens of thousands of people who'll be watching this episode and listening to this episode, and I realized that I could remain silent on the things that I am convinced are true and just stay safe, or I can use that platform to express, you know, my voice. Now, I get messages daily of people saying, I used to like you better when, before you got into, and I'm like, look, I've never not been into it. It's just we use the platform to voice the opinion. I wish that we lived in a country where everybody just loved on each other and could.
Sure.
But, you know, we were created, this country was founded on the ability to disagree and come back together. And one of those things that helps us do that is the symbols of this country, things like that flag.
Absolutely.
You know, everything, if you break down the meaning, you know, and I've had people want to tell me that the flag is racist and the flag is symbols of hate and things like that. And I'm like, man, you've been indoctrinated with some really weird BS.
Yeah.
And so I'm proud that you're out there doing what you're doing, because I know that in many ways it can be a thankless thing. And people look at that and say, okay, so what? You got a flag. You're putting a flag up. That's a big deal.
Well, and I don't honestly, at my age now, I don't care what people think. That if they don't already love the flag and what it stands for, I'm not going to change your mind by putting a flag up for them. Mm-hmm. That's not why I'm doing it. There's two reasons I'm doing it. One, like I said, I really feel like God says, this is what I want you to do. This is your service for me. Roger that. But the other thing I'm doing it for is those that served.
Yeah.
And as long as they get it, as long as we can shed a tear or say a prayer or drink a beer or whatever at the base of that flagpole, then my mission's accomplished.
Yeah.
And if someone wants to get on board with that hasn't been on board, great. Then I have reached that one person. But my meaning behind this is simple. Honoring those that served, honoring those who have put their country before themselves. And it doesn't matter if you're a first responder, a police officer, a fireman, paramedic, a doctor, a nurse. It doesn't matter. You're putting someone else before yourself. And that's what this is all about. Flags for Vets is about that. So being able to do that and being able to honor those that served in such a simple yet powerful way, putting a flagpole up for them, I can't think of a better way to do it.
Yeah.
And it does me, man, I'm telling you, people don't understand how much satisfaction I get when I see that veteran, because there have been very few. And I tell you, I can count on one hand and have a couple of fingers left of the number of veterans that have not broken down at the base of that flagpole, whether you served in a conflict or whether you're standing there with no legs. It's all that visceral feeling of that true sense of pride and patriotism of what, you know, they have fought for and some bled and lost limbs for. So that's who I do it for, and that's why I do it.
Spoken like a true Marine, even if they're standing there with no legs.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
That's the kind of thing I'd say right there.
Standing there with no legs.
Yeah, standing there with no legs. That's funny.
Lieutenant
Flags
Dan.
For – yeah. Well, Lieutenant Dan's got new legs.
I did do a Chris Corbin. Listen, I'm going to shout out to Chris Corbin. He's an old SF guy. He lives out in North Carolina. Chris is a great guy. Lost both his legs in war and came home and still accomplishing so much. Put a flag up for him last year.
Yeah.
Had a house built for him by Jared Allen, the former NFL player that's building homes for vets now. So, done one for no-legged people too.
No-legged people.
And he will tell you in a heartbeat. He'll give you
So our buddy Jacob Schick with 22 Kill, he was on the podcast and he came in here. Now my wife, sometimes she'll come in the studio and she saw the video. She wasn't in here that day. And of course, Jake's crazy Jake. He's sitting there and he's got flip flops on, right? And she's looking at the video. She said, I thought he was an amputee. And I said, well, he is. And she said, well, how's he wearing flip flops? I said, well, he got a fake foot that's designed to hold that flip flop. She's like, well, dang, that looks real. I said, well, up close,
that's
it don't.
That's pretty cool. I've never seen that before.
Yeah, it does. And I'm like, yeah, Jake got his little flip flop foot on there. You know, it's funny.
Yeah.
It's funny. But, you know, we were over there the other night, and we're going to get our buddy John Wayne Walding on the show. We haven't had him. I've known John Wayne for a few years now and haven't had a chance to get him on the podcast. But, you know, here's a guy that single amputee, Green Beret, and then goes back and becomes an Army sniper.
Yeah.
Green Beret sniper with one leg.
Yeah.
Which is unheard of, you know. And you get around these guys and you start hearing their stories. I was with Mike Day the other night in Tucson, Arizona. Mike was shot 27 times and still, after being shot 27 times, still killed five more people in Iraq. I mean, this was real stuff here. Yeah. I mean, these guys, I mean, Mike Day took they stuck a gun under his body armor and pulled the trigger. I don't know why they didn't just shoot him in the head. But 27 times non-lethal. I mean, they just took another bullet out of him recently he didn't even know was in there.
God.
Shot him in the rear end. It wound up in his stomach muscle. It just migrated up, and they put him in the back of a Suburban, laid the seat back, and cut him open and fished that bullet out of there. He wears it around his neck right now.
Good Lord.
He pulls out that necklace, and he says, "Hey, here's a bullet that shot me in the ass." And I'm like, "I don't want to touch it."
No, where's Ben?
I don't want to touch it, Mike.
Yeah, yeah,
but, I mean, you know, these are the kind of people that you look at and say, you know, we were just at the Chris Kyle benefit. And, I mean, Chris and Chad, who lost their life trying to help a veteran that was suffering, yeah. You know, and the guy murdered him. And, you know, we're honoring his memory 6 years later on this deal and his accomplishments and that family and what they've done. This is what the flag means. I mean, that's to Absolutely. Me where it is. I didn't go in the military because, one, you know, look, I graduated high school in 1991. At that point in time, like you said, most folks who were joining the military, either they didn't have an option, or it was a life goal and desire. Like, I had guys at the University of Georgia who were in the ROTC. They knew they were going in
right.
after they were done with school. They wanted to be there.
Right.
But that was few and far between. There weren't a lot of those guys. It wasn't as prevalent. And so, you know, either somebody couldn't go to college or something like that, or they couldn't afford college. And it was a different motivation. 9/11 happens, and now these guys are thinking, I want to go to war.
Yeah.
And a lot of people started signing up to do that. So looking back on that, and when 9/11 happened, something very major happened deep down in my soul. Like, there was a cosmic shift in the universe of my spiritual life. And I said, the world will never be the same again when that happened, because there was something so cosmically evil about 9/11. And we don't need to get into all that. But ever since then, I said, I'm gonna dedicate my life to doing everything I can to honoring these folks who have served and sacrificed.
Right.
And everything we do is going to be from that angle. So, you know, you go out there, you go to flagsforvets.us, and I encourage people to get in touch with you and do what they can and you know, give you so much that you got to keep hiring folks in Opelika to go around the country putting poles up with you.
Do you have like a GoFundMe set up for that? Or
I don't. The website's set up to make donations too.
Okay.
And I have people from time to time that do on Facebook do the birthday fundraiser kind of stuff.
Yeah.
And, you know, when I started this, I had my own goals. Mm-hmm. And my struggles have been really internal and putting more pressure on myself to do more than I guess really is humanly possible. And at the end of the day, I just need to slow down and have a little patience that God's plan is going to work out. Yeah. So, you know, when I say that the donations and the support haven't been there, it's a little misleading. I have to this point, I have been able to pay for every single flagpole that has been put up, 342 of them, like I said. But do I have that corporate sponsor or that individual that says, "Hey, man, I want to take this thing to the next level with you"? I haven't had that yet, and I just have to be patient that's going to happen.
And I encourage people listening to this, watching. I mean, you might, if it's not you, you might know somebody. I mean, if you're looking for organizations that. And that's one thing I love about serving on the board of American Valor with the Kyle family, because they're always helping raise money to help other organizations who are trying to, you know, get going. And I encourage people, you know, vote with your pocketbook, give, find those sponsors that are out there that says, "Hey, I want to come alongside and partner with you on this deal." Because look, we ain't ashamed to ask for it. We're capitalists in Studio 22, baby. We'll ask for it.
I tell, like I said before, two things are going to happen when I show up at your doorstep. You're going to call the police, you're going to write me a check. I mean, you know, what's it going to be? You're going to take the easy way or the hard way out.
Exactly.
But I do, you know, I'm a little misleading. I have about a dozen local businesses that provide support for me every month. It's not much, but listen, $500 for me is a lot.
Yeah.
So at $200 it costs to put one flagpole up. And that doesn't even include the cost of fuel and lodging and anything else, or if I have to fly somewhere. So those costs go up exponentially. But I do have businesses that have invested in me, local businesses that know me because I'm born and raised there. When I showed up at their doorstep, they knew who I was. They knew this wasn't something that's a fly-by-night that I'm going to be driving, you know, a jacked-up F-350 that's $80,000 that I paid for through the nonprofit. I've got a 2013 Silverado 1500. It's got 129,000 miles on it that I'm riding the wheels off of right now. So, you know, if there's a car dealership out there that wants to donate a truck, there's my plug. But I do have some businesses that, you know, that from time to time that sponsor me. But I'm always looking for the financial support that I don't have to worry about this, because I know, like I said, I'm going to continue to do this forever. I came across... about 6 months ago, I came across a company out of Holly, Michigan called Flagpoles, et cetera. At the time, I was using Valley Forge flags, and they were, you know, they were, there was a partnership where they were allowing me to purchase my flagpoles at cost versus retail, because I wasn't reselling them. I was using them as a donation. But the gentleman named Brian Mann that owns Flagpoles, et cetera, stepped up the game, and he said, "Look, man, I don't know what we can do. I just know I want to partner with you on some level." And they have really come up and showed up. And Flagpoles, et cetera, has been really, really good to me. They've allowed me to have the freedom of ordering flagpoles and paying for them at the end of the month versus having to for it up front. They've waived the shipping charges for me so that I'm not paying $700-$800 in shipping for four flagpoles when the flagpoles themselves cost half of what the shipping was. It's those little things for me that adds up to a lot. But not only that, but Flagpoles, et cetera, has taken it one step further. Brian he's got teams that go all over the country putting flagpoles up commercially for businesses and individuals. And he said, "Hey, man, send me your list of veterans that's waiting. And if I'm in a town where you got a vet that's been waiting for a while, let me put a flag up, you know, for him so you don't have to make that trip up." And he's done that for me three or four times so far. So as he goes through towns where I've got vets waiting, then and if he can swing it, he's going to do it. So it's those little things for me that have really allowed me to take a step back and take a deep breath, because I got people on my waiting list that have been there for a year and a half.
Wow.
And I, every day, man, I obsess about, you know, man, I need to get up there. I need to do this. I need to do that. But it's just not time. I mean, I just don't have the money yet. So, and there's only one of me. I joke when I say we, it's me, myself, and I. It's the three of us. I do have a couple of people that help me when they can. Both are Iraq vets. Both are guys that that served and were wounded in Iraq. And God bless them, they do what they can. One's name's Todd Rauch. And another was Kyle Golden, and both of them are suffering from injuries that they sustained from either sniper rounds or IEDs. But yet, you know, they're continuing to serve, and they jump in the truck with me and go and help me put flagpoles up. Yeah. So I do have some help. I have a chapter that started up right outside of Fort Bragg and right outside of Fayetteville, in a small town called Rayford, a Marine and his wife. And so I've got at least one official chapter that I have to ship flagpoles up, and they just put them up for me. I've been to North Carolina three times so far, put 21 flagpoles up, and I said, "Look, I can't keep, you know, I can't afford to keep coming up here." Yeah. So that's kind of the business model behind this, is that as I put these up in states where it's just too cost prohibitive for me to go back, I kind of pass the torch and say, "Hey, if there's anybody up here that wants to put a flag up for me, and I'll throw you some flags for vet shirts, and I'll send you the flagpoles, and you just put them up, and we'll worry about the logistics part, you know, when it happens."
Yeah.
So
it's good stuff. Opelika, Alabama. You're an Auburn fan, aren't you?
I'm an Auburn grad. I'm an Auburn fan. Quick story about that. My dad
found a chink in the armor, Ted. I knew there was a flaw with you, Jamie.
Look, I told you the other night, I drank almost as much beer at Georgia as I did at Auburn.
You did, that's right.
And Georgia's my second favorite team.
Redeeming
if they
weren't
playing
right
Auburn,
there.
Absolutely. I had a buddy of mine, Dale Shedd, that was in the Marine Corps with me, and Dale was from Athens. And when we got out of the service, I used to hang out up at Georgia on football weekends when
Prettier
Auburn was
girls.
Home. You know what? I'll flip a coin on any given day. You're exactly right. Girls in the South in general.
The South.
And I married a beautiful one myself. So.
Yeah.
I lost my train of thought right in the middle of that sentence.
What you were going to tell me a story about Auburn.
Oh, yeah. Anyway, my dad is extended family's from Birmingham. Mm-hmm. And in the early 60s, my dad played football at Banks High School up in Birmingham and got a scholarship to play football at Auburn under Coach Jordan. And he and my mom moved down there. Dad was playing ball for Auburn from 63 to 65, and so just, you know, grew roots there, and we've been there ever since. And I mean, I love the town. I love Opelika. I love Auburn and everything it stands for. I never have to worry about being in the middle of the Bible Belt, anyone ever having a problem me putting a flagpole up. And there's nowhere around there that you know, they aren't supportive of what I do.
Yeah. So it's a good place. It's a good place. I like to give it a hard time. You know, we got a place over in Northeast Alabama up on Sand Mountain. So.
Oh, yeah.
We redneck it up, too.
Oh.
Yeah, good times.
Hard not to up there.
I know, and it's a gorgeous place up there on the bluff right over there looking at the Tennessee River. I mean, it's nice. Well, anyway, I'm going to let you get on that airplane and go home. I appreciate you hanging out with us here in the studio talking about it. I encourage people to go to flagsforvets.us. I can't say it enough. I keep saying that, and we'll put it up here on the screen one more time. But I want to make sure that people go there. And you know, if you know somebody, you can offer, you know, for Jamie to come out and do that and get them on the list, or just donate. I mean, that's the thing. Donate.
Yeah.
Just make life easier for what you're doing.
Just patience. I mean, you know, like I said, it is just me doing it. And if you're willing to wait, I'll put a flagpole up for you. I promise I will. It may take me a little while, but I made you a promise, and I'll do it. So, you know. Same thing goes for you, Party Foul.
What you got, Party Foul?
We got a Facebook page, too, Flags for Vets.
Yeah. Flags for Vets. Do that. Yeah. Hit like, follow them, keep up with everything's going. And boy, I'm tired just listening because I just know how much you're doing and how much you're going and running and gunning, man.
Well, I mean, you stay on the road, too. So if you're ever in a town where I need a flagpole put up, I'm going to give you a call.
Okay.
Yeah, while you're there, you know, why don't you put a flagpole up for me?
I won't do it, but Steve will do it.
Yeah, okay.
I get Steve to pour a little concrete footer in there and
I need
stick
to swing
a pole
by the
in
Home
it.
Depot first, though.
I mean, absolutely. If you don't mind a flagpole hanging at about a 60-degree angle.
Well, you know what? When I show up at a Marine's house, Steve, what I do is I ask him, do you want the 90-degree or do you want the Iwo Jima model?
So on 4th of July, y'all can go pose underneath
it. Yeah, first couple were almost the Iwo Jima kind, you know, but I'm so OCD, I made sure they were 90-degree. But I do offer that.
That's funny. Yeah, old Neil McCoy, talking about him, he got one. He got a 50-footer put out in front of his place. Of course, he's got a big old property over in Longview,
Texas. Yeah, go big
Texas.
Or go home is what I always say,
he's got
right?
that big gate out there. And I told him, I said, you know, sometimes he'll – and Neil is so dang gracious. I mean, he is so gracious. He got an asylum out there, man. I'll tell you, he'll be sitting out there doing that, and he'll be talking and ride his little gator out there to the flagpole to do it. And there'll be people standing there at the gate, you know, wanting to talk to him or whatever, and he'll back that gator back over the sensor on the driveway so it'll open the thing up, and he'll just let him in the property. I said, man, you're going to get killed one day. But, I mean, it's Longview, Texas.
Yeah,
what
it's
you
Longview,
do?
Yeah.
I mean, just good old folks out
it's
there.
It's Neil McCoy. Nobody don't – everybody likes him.
Everybody loves Neil McCoy. Yeah. I mean, I don't, but whatever.
Yeah. You can't not like him.
I know. I love Neil. God bless him. He's a mess. But anyway, Jamie, thanks for coming, man.
Yeah,
prayers for you, safe travels, and all the good stuff as you're going around. And I promise you, any way we can ever help you, we want to do it. We're going to promote the heck out of it. And
thank you.
Yeah, glad having you on. So y'all go check him out. Get on Facebook, follow him. Also, go to the website and do it, flagsforvets.us. As always, we're about to get back on the road ourselves. So if you want to find us out there, come have some laughs with us. Go to watchchad.com and find the tour schedule. We're about to open the floodgates, I hope, on a lot more cities and dates for the remainder of the year. And Steve, I think we're going to change the name of the tour. I think it's about time to, I think now that we're going into cities for the second time, the Star Spangled Banter name, it's almost time to be laid to rest. I think it's time. I got ideas.
All right. I got like ideas.
I think we're going to call it... This show is guaranteed to piss at least three of you off comedy tour.
I'd shoot for more than three. I mean, yeah.
No, our folks are pretty solid, man. Pretty you know, they solid. Come out to the Did show. You? They know what they're getting into. They have a good time. But I've never done a show where I didn't get a message afterwards where somebody was mad about the opener or, you know, or, you know, I might have said the word penis or something like that.
Whoops.
I might have said it. I did say the word penis.
Somebody left mad once.
Oh, it was Steve. Now, Steve was sitting out in the lobby, and he could see them leaving.
Yeah.
Like if there's a couple of them, you know, we'll have, whatever, 1,000 people, 1,200 people in the room, and there'll be one or two that inevitably get up and go.
But you got to ask yourself, when you show up there, did you not know, I mean, those one or two, that what
would you think you were coming to?
I mean,
they
seriously.
Either want a political rally or they want a church service.
Like going to a Richard Pryor concert and not hearing him swear.
Yeah, I mean, exactly. And
seriously.
We don't, you know, my set, I tell people all the time, I don't swear. I it's not a vulgar show. Now, if I have an opener, sometimes I can control that. Sometimes I cannot control who the opener is. Because it depends on if the promoter has somebody that they need to stick on the venue or whatever. And they just ways to work and wheel and deal and make the deals happen. And sometimes you have to say, and I usually encourage those folks to keep it at PG-13, but people have a different interpretation of what PG-13 means.
True.
Now, you come into my show, I'm going to show you the edge. I'm not going to push you over it. Now, if you choose to go out there and jump off of it, that's your own you.
Yep.
But I want you to laugh. And Steve's exactly right. You got folks that come, they either think they're going to a church service or a political rally, and it's a little bit of both and neither of either. So, you know, it's a comedy show. We have fun. It's a good time.
Did you pass the plate?
No, but they do write me a pretty good check at the end of the night. It ain't so bad.
But that's a good idea.
Well, we do have ways, and we usually have stuff like we've got, we're going to start adding – our friend Chad Robichaud, who has Mighty Oaks Foundation out in Arizona, helping vets recover, and he does it free of charge for them. And we're starting to put a lot of his pamphlets out and stuff like that, and try to encourage people with awareness. And so, yeah, you know, in that sense, I want people to give. We yeah. are blessed, man. This is the greatest country ever in the history yeah. of the world. It yeah. is. I mean, this is the greatest
Hands
idea.
Down.
That our founding fathers were inspired by God. I truly believe that when they created this country, they did. And it's, we got our flaws, we got our sins, we got our scars, but hey, we're humans and everybody's got that. And anyway, I'm going to shut up because I got to sneeze anyway. So I'm going to end this episode. So go check out Jamie Popwell, follow him, support him, do everything you can for Party Foul Steve, Puppet Master Mark, Candice, Queen of the Ethiopians, who is conspicuously missing, and Sona, who's asleep on the floor. God bless her. I love that dog.
Yep, she's out.
My wife would say, no more, no more.
Yeah,
my wife says no more dogs.
Yeah,
well, we're just gonna get a bigger piece of property. So we
that's all
more
you
dogs.
Need to do. That's absolutely.
Right. We'll see you next time for the Chad Prather Show. I love y'all. God bless. Bye.